going to press recording. Okay, great. All right. So welcome back, everybody. I want to, I'm so pleased that you decided to join us again for another session of Introverted Leaders Around the World. We have these every month, and we're glad that you're tuning into the YouTube channel to learn more about how introversion takes many forms in different countries and different cultures. And I'm thrilled today to introduce you to our guest, Dr. Frank Hagenow. And Frank is a German speaker. I was going to say based, but he has just recently moved to Italy. So we're going to hear more about that. And let me tell you a little bit about Frank Hagenow, CSP, which for those of you who know or have been listening, is Certified Speaking Professional. And Frank supports managers and companies, Dr. Frank Hagenow supports managers and companies in building long-lasting, trustful relationships with their employees and customers, as well as making the right decisions in difficult situations. Entrepreneurs and managers who want to be successful in the long run do not need to fall back on mind games. They lead with decency and respect. And how this can work in everyday life, Frank Hagenow shows in inspiring speeches and seminars and coachings. Dr. Hagenow holds university degrees in psychology and tourism, and he studied in Germany, especially focused on educational and work-related and organizational psychology. He's held numerous seminars for managers. In fact, Frank and I met through our common association, the National Speakers Association. And he works a lot in conflict resolution and has supported numerous top managers in his coachings, as well as having been a psychological evaluator and a managing director. He has international recognition as a psychologist. It's called EuroPsy. And in the US, as I mentioned, he has his CSP, which is a designation that really only 10% of professional speakers hold worldwide. Frank travels all over the world. It's a thrill for me to catch him today. And thanks to Zoom, Frank, we get to talk to you out of Venice, Italy, a place that many people love. So welcome.
Yes, thank you very much, Jennifer, for this warm welcome. In a long time, I haven't had that much pressure for all this gratitude, and I'm really happy to be with you. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely, and you know, I do appreciate it because Frank had to dig out of some boxes to get his earpieces and his cords. So that is why we're very grateful today.
Yeah.
So
we're
going to start out, Frank, with the first question that I like to ask all of our guests, and that's thinking back about, you know, what was your very first job, you know, when you were younger, and what you actually learned from that job. So could you share a little bit about that with us?
Yes, before I decided to study psychology, I was a driving instructor. This was my first job in Germany. I owned driving schools in the Germany in the eastern and the western part. And so this was my first job teaching people how to drive.
Wow, that is a very brave occupation, I would think. I'm glad you're still here with us, you know.
Me too. Me too.
Do you have any experiences you remember when it was a little scary with perhaps a driver that wasn't so good in the beginning? Any people that you remember?
Yeah, well, I have a particular situation in the final examination and the practical examination. And as you might know, in Germany, there are this traffic light crossings, and there are also on every crossing, there are traffic signs, stop signs or other signs, just in case the traffic light wouldn't work or is switched off at night. But these traffic signs you only have to follow if the traffic light is off. And so we drove in the final examination towards a green traffic light with the stop sign on it. Mm. And approximately 10 meters before the crossing, my student just saw this stop sign, and I don't know what he thought. Maybe he thought he has to stop now, and within a second he stepped into the brake and tried to stop there, and a really, really big truck behind us could just manage to stop behind us, but this was really, really close.
And
as a driving instructor, you can't do anything if your student is braking. You can't do anything to stop him braking. Yeah.
Well, you tell me too that you actually after those scary experiences sitting next to the students, you actually ran several schools, and that it helped you in your current role in terms of being a business coach and a leader. Could you talk about what did you learn from the experience of growing that business?
Yeah, I think the first thing is when you're working as a driving instructor, you have to be able to adjust from one moment to another to different people and to different needs and different levels of education. And so I think this is something I trained quite well in this period to adjust to different situations quite quickly. And the other thing is to work with employees, and now I'm in the position as a speaker or a business or CEO coach, which helps me because I am not only talking about leadership, but I also have this leadership experience by myself. And this is quite helpful in understanding the daily hustles CEOs are struggling with.
Yes, I'm sure it does, and it gives you credibility as well as empathy for those people and what they're experiencing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So let's talk a little bit about introversion, because that is the theme of our podcast. We had talked earlier about one of the ways we determine whether or not somebody is more on the introverted spectrum, and it is a spectrum, or extroverted, is how they get their energy and the need that they have to recharge after being with people. So I wondered, when I asked you that question, you know, what when you would you consider yourself, Frank, on the spectrum of introversion and extroversion? Where would you put yourself on that bell curve?
This is not that easy to answer for me, because I think I've got both parts in me. I'd like to be on my own. I'd like to think. I'd like to read. I'd like to write. But on the other hand, I also love to be on stage and to expose myself, of course, and my topics to others. I just published a book, as you might know, and so this is also about expose yourself and your opinions, and being criticized for that sometimes. So I think I'm quite combining both of them, although I like more the introvert part than the extrovert, because this suits me more.
Yes, and that's exactly what a lot of people say, and it sounds like you honor and recognize both of those parts, but you do enjoy the writing and the reading and the kind of being alone and recharging that way. And I wonder, with your work with your clients, what do you observe about how they honor? Maybe we should back up a little bit. Tell us the kind of work you do as a business coach. What would be like a typical sort of case you might work on with your client?
I'm often working with clients, managers, CEOs in the middle of their lives, between 50 and 60, like myself. I'm 57 now, and they often have achieved already a lot within their business lives, and sometimes they are challenged with new decisions whether to take the next career step or make a move to another company or whatever. Uh-huh. And really often they are not in the situation to have to earn money anymore because they are settled. They have one or two houses, sometimes one or two marriages behind them. And so they are not going anymore for, okay, I need to have the next raise of my salary to buy my next Porsche mm-hmm. or Mercedes, whatever. And so it's often about the situation. Should I go for the next step, or is there something more valuable in life mm-hmm. than earning money or take the next career step on this career ladder? They are often reflecting what is important, what is really important for them. Because in the first part of their business lives, it was about achieving and getting the status and getting rewarded for the things they did. And now they are often asking questions about does it make sense to go on that way, or is there maybe something which is more valuable? And that is, often that it is. Helpful.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. Go on. You said often it is.
It uh-huh. is, and it is the personal relationships they are referring to at the end. They say, "Oh, it's I missed so much time with spending with my children because I was busy in work." And now I have my grandchildren, and maybe I can give back something at least to them, mm. and I enjoy family life, and I enjoy spending time just on my own or hiking through the Alps or whatever. It's more about asking themselves about the sense of life, if you put it that high, and if they might change something.
Yeah, it sounds like that takes a lot of reflection and what's the, you know, and thinking and kind of just deciding, you help guide them as to what their values are now at this stage in their life. Yeah. What's the process you encourage them to do when they are going through this?
The first thing is to explore the different aspects they are thinking of, and the one thing is the career aspect, and the other aspects they are almost every time hidden underneath the surface. And so scratching at the surface and getting deeper and deeper to the real meaning is something which is a really, really interesting and helpful way to get more clarity.
And what would this specific step you would be if you were advising somebody who is going through this transition and they were wanting to do more self-reflection about the next step? Do you advise them to write about it, or is there an assessment they take, or what specific step might they take to get closer to understanding what, you know, is important to them?
This might refer to a little bit to your topic concerning introversion, and it's often about listening to the silent voices you've got within yourself, and these inner team members you have, which are not on the front line, but they are quite quiet and coming up with some ideas and giving a stage to these introverted inner team members mm-hmm. is something which works quite well.
Mm. So listen, so take the time to reflect, and not, you know, I imagine a lot of these type A kind of leaders, as you say, they're kind of not interested in that as much anymore, and you help guide them to what's important to them right now.
If they want to,
if they're open to that. Now, Frank, I've seen you up on the stage, just to shift the topic a little. You're very energized, you're very animated. And many introverts are able to present and, in fact, shine when they're prepared and they're up there speaking, if they know what their role is. How do you get yourself, you said you've come alive on stage, I think you used that word. So could you talk a little bit about, just briefly about that, about, you know, how speaking works for you and why you like it?
Yeah. I think the first thing is to know my content, and I work a lot of on my content to know what to talk on the stage and be aware of delivering valuable content. Uh-huh. And being sure of my content gives me the liberty to step aside and to try different things or to engage with the audience. But it all starts with reflecting on writing my speech and rehearsing it. And there's a lot of preparation. Nobody will notice on stage. Mm-hmm. But this is something I need to feel comfortable on stage.
Great. Well, then you do seem very comfortable. And I think I would encourage anybody who checks out your videos, and you have an English speaking page. And no, it's great because you have it in German, but I love that you have the subtitles. And so you know, it really makes it accessible to so many more people. Could you talk a little bit before we get into the German culture? I wanted to ask you about the mind games phrase, because that was in your bio, and you kind of have branded yourself with that. What do you mean by mind games, to avoiding mind games?
This is referring to manipulation, to psychological trickery, to tricks and mind games CEOs or managers use to reach their goals, not being aware of the damage they leave behind. Because when people are fooled or feeling fooled, they normally don't like this feeling, and they won't follow you anymore. You might fool people once, you will probably not fool them twice. And so being on a long-term perspective successful means to resist the temptation to use some psychological trickery, although it sometimes works. This is the reason why manipulation and trickery is used, because you are sometimes successful, especially on a short-term perspective.
Mm-hmm. So you try to bring that, to make people aware of that. What would be an example of a mind game that somebody might play, very briefly?
Yeah, there's a wide range from little telling little white lies to people up to lying and betraying people or stealing from them in order to reach your own objectives. And for instance, let me give you an example. If you are an employee and you have a good idea for improving business, and you will go to your CEO or your manager and you tell him, your boss, here, I've got this nice idea, and your boss tells you, okay, thank you very much. Send me an email. I'd love to know more about it. But in reality, he's not interested in it, and he puts it in a garbage bin as soon as he receives it, and he'll never turn back to you referring to that. This is something, some kind of trickery, giving you the feeling you are welcome and I'm interested in your ideas, but at the end you will discover, okay, it is just a trick to keep me on track there.
Do you think that has anything to do with personality type, like, or there's not much correlation between, let's say, this lack of integrity that you're talking about, or lack of trust, and introversion and extroversion? Do you think that one personality type is more prone to that than another, or really doesn't have anything to do with that?
I think in daily business life, these habits are often revealed by accident. People are not aware of the damage they will cause. They don't mean to harm people. They are not doing it on purpose, but they don't think about it, and so they are not aware of the damage. And often they do not receive feedback, and so they are not going to change anything. So I don't think it's often done by purpose. Sometimes people behave like they think it is expected of them, sometimes they behave because they don't know any alternative. There's a wide range of the reasons to that behavior.
So becoming aware of that sounds like a first step. And then what would be a next step you would advise your clients to do if they're, you know, to avoid this, or if they've been engaging in this kind of more negative behavior? What do you suggest to them?
The first suggestion is to skip from telling people to listening to people. This is something especially CEOs are not that familiar with, and I'm not only talking about listening, but trying to understand what is said and what is meant. So listening to the things you will get between the lines, and you often get things to know if you are really up to listen, and if you are really inviting people to tell them what it's up to them or for them, if you are invited to tell in an authentic and honest way. From my experience, people love to share their knowledge and their ideas. They are only reluctant when they had bad experiences with being honest.
Mm-hmm. That lack of trust. So I'm glad you're talking about the listening, because that is a real strength of introverted leaders, that they're known for listening. People will say, you'll ask them, who's the best manager or leader you ever have? And they'll describe somebody who was an incredible listener. As you say, Frank, they really show by their active listening, paraphrasing and all those things, they are truly hearing underneath the lines. So I'm so glad that you brought that up as a strength. I want to switch gears just for, as we kind of wind down our interview here, to ask you a little bit about culture. Now, I mentioned earlier that you have recently made a move to Italy, probably a dream of a lot of people. And but you actually worked and lived your dream. What did you say about that?
Yeah, this was a dream for me also for a long time. I fell in love with Italy when I was a student, and I was here on a study course with my schoolmates here, and so it took a long time to take
to make it happen.
Yeah, sometimes you shouldn't. Leave your goals out of sight and stick to them on the long-term perspective.
You made it happen. As you say, Frank, you can work anywhere as a professional speaker and as a consultant. So just asking you now a question about, you know, in terms of the culture and back to our lens of introversion versus extroversion, some countries embrace more of the you know, the out there energy, the, if you go talk about yin and yang energy, for instance, in Asia, it's much more accepted to not be speaking very much, and to kind of, you know, keep the, whether it be a group think or a sort of a quiet way of expressing yourself through writing, et cetera. Whereas in the US, we have a very type A type of a culture, you know, where I'm thinking particularly in the workplace, you know, but it does affect us the way we've been brought up in our families and in our culture. So what would you say in terms of, well, first of all, if we stay with Germany, where you're from and where you live most of your life, what would you say about the acceptance of people who are more introverted, who aren't the first to speak up in meetings, who reflect before they speak, who like their time alone? Any thoughts on Germany and how encouraging it is for introverts, or how aligned it is with introverts?
I think in Germany, as you know, there is this stereotype of the Germans being everywhere punctual and keeping straight to the agenda and being very, very strict with themselves. And I think these stereotypes occur because they are true.
And every stereotype is based on some truth, at least,
yes,
right?
Yes, what on the one hand might be an advantage in business life sometimes hinders you on the other side, and the flip side to that coin is that especially in the leadership level, you often have people who are extroverts, and they are paid for knowing exactly what they want to achieve, and telling people where to go, and being a strong leader, which is rewarded quite often in business life. I think here in Italy, it's a little bit the other way around, because here people are more socializing, they are more improvising, and you do not have to know everything from scratch and to the end in order to make things happen as well. I think this is something which is different, and especially in Germany or in Austria, where I worked a lot, there is also this willingness to respect people, to put them on a high shelf, rewarding titles like being a doctor or professor, this is something which is quite different to the US, where people are more common with each other and more comfortable with using their names and not referring to them as Mr. Whatever, and this is something which is I think different in our cultures.
Very interesting. You know, I hadn't really thought about that. So sort of the I'm hearing you say with Italy a little more loose, kind of the maybe right brain, where people are encouraged to improvise, you said, and be creative. You don't have to have all the answers. Might even be a comfortable environment for people who are quieter, who are self-censoring, you know, or say, oh, I don't want to speak up because I'm not the leader. As you said, the hierarchy influences that in Germany and Austria. So it's like maybe it's a little bit more comfortable for people who are, if they can get a word in with some of the Italians who like to talk so much, right?
That's perfectly right.
It's a very interesting different dynamic. And I wonder in business, as you work more in Italian businesses, what you're going to see.
And on the other hand, you have to be able to step aside and think out of your own boxes, be able to to switch to another kind of dealing with things, which is not that easy for Germans, I guess. I've got a colleague here, and he's Italian, and he often says to me, Frank, don't be so German. So this is something.
What does he mean by that, Frank? What does he mean when he tells you that?
I think he refers to being very, very punctual and asking what are we doing next, and what is going to happen there, and where can I go, and what do we need, and so on. And so just more going with the flow would be I think a good expression to
Oh, Frank, yeah, going. I was going to laugh. I was going to say the next time we have a chat, maybe you'll even be late for the call or something.
Yeah, maybe.
which I doubt it. I was laughing with you earlier, right? I was telling, when I was speaking over there with Dirk's group, Dirk Eilert's group, everybody was in their seats, you know, 20 minutes ahead of time. Before the class, like ready to go. And I was like, oh, I'm just getting organized. So, but I think that climate can really affect how comfortable people are in being who they are. Because we want everybody to be able to bring themselves to work and not have to censor themselves so much, you know? Well, this has been a fascinating conversation. I could talk to you for another hour, but I know we don't have that. And our listeners probably need to get on with their days. I would love to just end. I want to thank you so much for being a part of this dialogue. And it's been so enlightening.
Thank you very much. It was my pleasure, Jennifer.
And I would, you know, tell us about, you know, how people can reach you. And you mentioned a new book that you have, and I know I think it's in German, but tell us what that's about. And particularly how folks can connect with you, because our world is a lot smaller now in terms of being able to talk and to relate.
Yeah, I love to connect with your listeners to get some feedback and to know more about their experiences. And as I'm just expanding my speaking business more globally and internationally, I'm working on a translation of my book, which might be published in the middle of this year in English. Also, the German title is Leadership Without Mind Games, and its subtitle is Winning Over People with Ethics and Decency. And this is something I'd like to translate into into an English version. As you mentioned, I also have an English website you can refer to, and there are also English videos, not only with English subtitles, but now already in English language. There's a show reel, and you just can go to my website, which is frank-hagenow.com, and Hagenow is spelled Hagenow. And so this might be a first approach.
Absolutely. And we will put that on our notes for the program too. So this is just wonderful. I so appreciate your time. It was so valuable to hear about my friend, my German Italian friend. And I hope to see. what should we say? We should say, I guess a lot of people say ciao in Germany now too, right? So ciao.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, ciao would be appropriate. Yeah,
that would be appropriate. And danke, Frank. Yeah. And I look forward to posting this and connecting with you very soon. Thank you so much.
Great. Thank you too. Okay. It was my pleasure.
Bye-bye.
Bye.